Good morning, St. Paul's, and welcome to worship. We know a lot of you are home online with us today, and we are grateful for those of you who are here too to be together on this snowy Sunday morning in January. It is good to be together. A few announcements that I want to make. Number one, we want to be praying for Marielle, our tech arts assistant, as she's home with COVID. And so I ask for your grace as we do tech, not only with one volunteer, but with two right now. With three volunteers. It's a little different morning for us here. So just know that is part of it. So online, we will do our best and be as attentive as we can, and we might not be able to fix it. So just be aware of that, that's a possibility. It could. I also want to announce, make sure that you look in the newsletter for opportunities to go to the Negro League Baseball Museum, and also the Nelson Sikh team is putting together some learning on location opportunities to go with our KC Heart series, and we would love for you to be a part of those. Between services today, we're going to have a meeting for those who are interested in being part of a leadership group that's working on refugee settlement. So if you're interested in doing that, we're just going to stay in here in the sanctuary. So we'll meet at 10:15 to do that. So if you're looking for a way to serve, that might be a really good opportunity to do so. But with all of that being said, make sure you sign in, and there's a QR code on your screen for a second, and then we will... Not yet, but there will be one, let us go to God and worship together.
Hey, Paul's, it's exciting to be with y'all today. If you're here with us in person, I'm going to invite you to stand with us for worship. If you're joining us online, I'll invite you to just press in and receive and to join with us in worship as well.
This dry and desert land, I tell myself keep walking home. There's something up ahead, water falling like a song. An everlasting stream, your river carries me home. Let it flow, let it flow. Soul, a well that never will run dry. I rambled on my own, never believing I would find. Everlasting stream, your river carries me home. Let it flow.
Come on
and rain down on us, rain down on us, Lord.
Let's sing, come on, rain down.
Come on and rain down on us, rain down on us, Lord.
God, we thank you because there's a place for us in your house. You invite us in with a ring and a kiss, Lord. There's always a place for us. Lord, anything that we bring with us today, whether we're at home, whether we're here, I pray that we remember there's nothing that can separate us from the love of God. That you invite us in. There's a place for us at the Father's house. Thank you, Lord. Took a breath when I doubt you would remind me how wonderful you made. You're an artist and a potter on the canvas and the clay. Let's sing that verse again in my mother's room. In my mother's room, you formed me with your hands. Before I took a breath, when I doubted, Lord, remind me how wonderful you made. You're an artist and a potter on the canvas and the clay. You make all things.
You make all things work together. Future and for my good, you make all things work together for your glory and for your name.
There's a healing light.
There's a healing light just beyond the clouds. Though I've walked through fire, I see clearly now. I'm not the past and wasted, no failure or mistake. You're an artist and a potter on the canvas.
You make all things work together for my future and for my good. You make all things work together for your glory and for, let's sing it again, you make all. All things work together for my future and for my good. You make all things work together for your glory and for your name.
I doubt it, Lord, remind me how wonderful you are. You're an artist and a potter on the canvas and the clay. And nothing has been wasted, no failure or mistake. You're an artist and a potter on the canvas and the clay. When I doubt it, Lord, remind me how wonderfully made. You're an artist and a potter on the canvas. failure or mistake. You're an artist and a potter. I'm the canvas and the clay. We make all things together for my future. For my future and for my good, we make all things work together for your glory and for your name.
God, we trust you in the trial and the process and the waiting, Lord. We know that you make all things work together for our good and for your glory, Lord. We thank you that you are good and that you're with us in the process, Lord. And we just trust you and we know that you're a good God and that you've got it and you're taking care of us. We love you, Lord. Help us to remember. Help us to stay faithful. We love you, Lord Jesus. Amen. You may be seated.
Amen, amen. It is time for Kids Connection, and so you can head out with Pastor Geneva and volunteers to go. We will cheer you on. Have so much fun. Love it. We continue our series today called KC Heart, Emphasis on the Art. We are focusing on public art here in the city and using it as a way into the gospel, a way into knowing God in a different way, and also having the tools to look outside our windows and know that God is in even our city, in the most basic things. And so our scripture today, as we focus on the shuttlecocks of the Nelson Atkins Museum, our scripture today is Mark 6, 1 through 6. Hear these words. He left that place and came to his hometown, and his disciples followed him. On the Sabbath, he began to teach in the synagogue, and many who heard him were astounded, and they said, "Where did this man get all this? What is this wisdom that has been given to him? What deeds of power are being done by his hands? Is not this the carpenter, the son of Mary, and the brother of James, and Joseph, and Judas, and Simon, and are not his sisters here with us?" And they took offense at him. And then Jesus said to them, "Prophets are not without honor except in their hometown and among their own kin and in their own house." And he could do no deed of power there, except that he laid his hands on a few sick people and cured them. And he was amazed at their unbelief. And then he went, Then he went about among the villages teaching. Will you pray with me? God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of each and every one of our hearts, wherever we are today, be acceptable in your sight. For God, you are our rock and our strength and our redeemer. Amen. So the shuttlecocks at the Nelson Atkins Museum are a thing in Kansas City that are endearing, but I never quite knew what they were about, right? I haven't actually been to the Nelson before, true confessions. You know, it's like weird moving somewhere right before COVID. But I see these shuttlecocks everywhere, posters and t-shirts. I mean, I even got a Casey Shuttlecock's coaster for Christmas this year. And until I started about thinking about this series, I had no idea why they were built or really anything about them. Let's just say, though, it became kind of an obsession. I had to stop myself from continuing to read once I started, because there is a really great book by a man named Edward Olszewski on the shuttlecocks and everything you'd probably ever want to know about them, and then some, you know. And as you can see, as you might know, for those of you who are online, the main, you know, they're the main thing you hit back and forth in badminton. And there at the Nelson, there are some on the front lawn and some on the other side of the building on the back lawn. It's said to be an image as if the gods were playing badminton and the Nelson was the net. And those, you know, creators, they thought about the feathered headdress of our native siblings who owned these lands first. Prairie windmills, lawn games with birdies. They considered then, you know, birdies the yard bird. That led into the nickname of Charlie Bird Parker, a legendary Kansas City saxophonist. Other influences included the feathered wings of the sphinxes at Liberty Memorial that shielded the eyes from the horrors of war. There was a flight motif, thinking about the famous aviator Amelia Earhart, and even the popularity of basketball. You can see it's a little bit of a nod to, like, some of the early drawings had a tornado that was the net with the ball at the end of it. And so that was part of some brainstorming from the early days there. All of those things led to the shuttlecocks. Those fascinating, endearing sculptures our city loves so much. There is an echo. I'm not sure if it's bouncing, but it is coming back at me, so I'm not sure if there, maybe these mics or something. We can work on it, but so if you would have asked, though, if in 1993, when these were going up, if you would have asked Kansas City whether they thought that the shuttlecocks would be some endearing thing Kansas City was known for, on prints and shirts and even coasters people give you for Christmas, I'd say, after learning more about them, that there would be significantly mixed reviews on the reactions, and that is because there were significantly mixed reviews on their initial creation. It was quite the controversy. The first letter to the editor appeared in the Star on February 15, 1993, objecting to the intrusion of the sculptures on the pristine front lawn of the museum. 10 days later, the next one came. It said, quote, "The public has a right to have a say in what happens to the front lawn of the Nelson. Right now, the park board is the gatekeeper. The three members would be correct to be skeptical of this project, no matter how many of Kansas City's social leaders and arbiters of taste think it's a great idea." Of course, you know, over the course of the next few months, as people were making this decision, there were letters calling them a giant waste, definitely not art. The Star published articles that said they were, quote, "unnecessary baubles and distractions at odds with the Nelson's environment." They asked, what does badminton have to do with Kansas City anyway? Which I feel like I might agree a little bit there, but there's that. But they even mocked the names of the artists. I'm going to work on pronouncing these, but Klaas Oldenburg and Koosie van Bruggen are the two artists there, and people were making fun of their names. It got pretty contentious, so much so that the people who opposed it tried to bring it to the big guns and really go to battle here. So they called the closest neighborhood association. They were like, "Here we go. You know, this is how we're gonna get this stopped." And so they were hoping the neighbors would be upset about these ugly giant sculptures to be. And the response from the Southmoreland Neighborhood Association said, Our board feels that this would be a delightful acquisition for you and would bring a smile to even the most grumpy of our Kansas Cityans. Burn, right? When you read about the shuttlecocks today, it includes the beginnings characterized in controversy. You hear that story if you look them up at all. And we all know, you know, that the naysayers obviously lost, and they are boldly there. So, of course, there was something of some smoothing over to be done after this had happened. So the Star's art critic did a whole thing to praise Oldenburg's art, characterizing him as, quote, the veteran pop art provocateur, and the sculptures of, quote, another of his characteristically witty and unexpected amplifications of everyday objects. She quoted an art historian, Ted Seligson, saying that maybe the shuttlecocks would reduce the severity of the building's facade. Which, let's just be real, like, is that praise for the shuttlecocks or like a jab at the Nelson's building? It's like my favorite praise, right? Well, at least it makes people look at this ugly thing instead of that ugly thing. Tell us how you really feel, right? But in the end, she said, whether you enjoy the shuttlecock exhibit or squabble over it, it's all part of the experience. And it's interesting to me all these years later that the story of the rejection of the shuttlecocks at the beginning, years ago, still gets told. When obviously the rejection wasn't much of a success. But I think that that's some of the charm in it, right? And our scripture today helps me realize what knowing the controversy can do to our perceptions. The Gospel of Mark shares miracle stories that Jesus had just healed a woman who reached out and touched him, and then a young girl of a church leader. And he left that place, Jesus did, it says, and he came to his hometown with his disciples. His hometown that included the people who raised him, and it says his kin, his family. So he's been doing amazing ministry, and he goes where he is known, and he teaches, and people are astonished. Where did he learn this? Is this not the carpenter, the son of Mary? And instead of receiving the teaching, Mark writes that they took offense at him. Other translations say they stumbled, or they were scandalized, or they fell foul of him, or my personal favorite, They found him too much for them. He was just too much. They rejected him. And you need to know that rejection, it's not a stranger in Scripture. Old Testament prophetic texts often go there. Ezekiel, for example, says the prophet is commissioned to go to a rebellious people and to speak the word of God to them, whether they hear or whether they refuse to hear. That is the calling. It's repeated in Scripture a lot. But it's interesting in Mark especially, even compared to the other Gospels who tell this same story about Jesus being rejected in his hometown, is that in Mark's, it specifically focuses on the fact that the people in his hometown, his family, his known community rejected him. And this actually gives a bookend to a passage that happens earlier in Mark. What we read today is from chapter 6. This happens in chapter 3 in a place where Jesus kind of rejects his family. In chapter 3 it says, then his mother and his brothers came, and standing outside they sent to him and called him. The crowd was sitting around him, and they said to him, your mother and your brothers and sisters are outside asking for you. And Jesus replied, who are my mothers and my brothers? And looking at those who sat around him, he said, here are my mother and my brothers. Whoever does the will of God is my brother and my sister and my mother. So then the passage that we have today about the crowd and the kin rejecting Jesus, when he says that, when Mark says that his family and his community rejected Jesus, it's sort of a communal judgment, or at least a foreshadowing about whether they are doing the will of God, whether they're doing the will of God. That is Jesus' family. And I actually find this a little bit comforting, this passage about Jesus being rejected for several different reasons. The first is that sometimes institutional church assumes family looks like one thing. And Jesus never, ever makes everyone seem perfect in family, because they aren't. And family can sometimes be broken. That's the first thing I like about that. The second thing I think is because there was no judgment in this passage for the questions that were asked. Seeking answers to the questions weren't a problem. Like, who is this? Is this not Mary's son? The passage asks the questions. The community asked the questions. And then they made a decision based on those questions. They took offense at him. He was too much for them. Questions are relationship builders. Rejection breaks relationship and trust and makes community difficult, right? But not impossible. So I wish that we had more adjectives listed for how Jesus feels at the end of this rejection. But instead, we just know that he healed a few sick people and he was amazed at the unbelief of his community. It didn't say he was sad or hurt, but amazed. I think there's an openness to being corrected when we are amazed. I think there's a willingness to hear something different. Maybe amazed is a word of grace. The very next thing Jesus did was send his disciples out two by two to go and heal and anoint people. The rejection didn't end the relationship. It sprang him into purpose even more. The controversy was almost a good thing. It led them into deeper mission. It got them thinking. It got them seeking that community. It moved his friends out into discipleship. So I want to jump back again to the shuttlecocks at the Nelson, because it's like we have these beacons of a similar message here in Kansas City. You see, there's something sort of beautiful about the lingering controversy of this exhibit. Sheila Kemper-Dietrich of the Parks Commission back then said, quote, "Controversy is okay. We need a breath of fresh air. We need challenging." Another person said, quote, "Three cheers for the sputtering, fuming debates the birdies have caused. The birdie controversy creates a sense of community clearly much needed here." Can you hear the longing for upending the status quo back in 1993? That maybe it was okay that it wasn't a boring monument that everyone thought belonged, you know? The book I read about the shuttlecocks had a whole chapter about the bigger why behind the controversy, at least their thoughts about it. They thought it was less an issue of a bizarre choice of subject and more that it didn't line up with what monuments are supposed to be. That we all know what sculptures and monuments telling a story about a city are supposed to be. A memorial to someone, or about something. A recognized pioneer, a change maker. They even usually look a certain way. Like a famous white dude molded of stone or brass or something, right? But this book said that monuments need mimicry to maintain traditions. And the shuttlecocks didn't have it. Instead, they, quote, "represent a secular liturgy disrupted." They represent a secular liturgy disrupted. It was art that was supposed to represent human interaction with the world as it is, not as it was. And maybe the conflict was that it was a whole lot easier to go visit something that was known and past and bound than this. Embracing the controversy then was a way of building community, of creating the will to interact with the world as it is, not as it was. So, St. Paul's, what would it look like to embrace the controversy that Jesus invites? One commentary I read said that the reason his own people did not believe in Jesus was probably because they knew him so well. They even said, "Is this not the carpenter? And are not his relatives here with us?" It was inconceivable to them that God would be at work in the commonplace. And this makes sense because the counter to this was that people were looking for signs. They wanted miracles. They wanted fancy, exotic, marvelous things to happen for there to be proof that there was a Messiah. So they were rejecting the fact that Jesus could be as ordinary as a man they'd watched grown up right before their eyes. With the shuttlecocks, it might have been that they hoped it would be something more predictable, and yet the sculpture turned out to be an everyday living object. With Jesus, his people hoped that the Messiah would be a little mightier than a dude who builds door frames. And yet, Jesus turned out to be so known and familiar to them that it took them off guard. And so embracing the controversy of Christ might look like simply letting ourselves see and experience the realness of Christ that offered a kingdom of God breaking in through ordinary ways we never thought possible. He was the outlier in the expected way the kingdom of God was going to be made real. That is the kind of controversy I dream about for the church. That we can be people who believe in a Savior who is inviting healing and wholeness in ways that challenge the status quo enough that people ask questions. Faith and life that challenge the status quo enough that it is actually transformative rather than a dull lull of life as we know it and can expect it. But instead, embracing life as we believe God can make it. Jesus was rejected after he healed people. So if that got people concerned, imagine what the little things that change their worlds and ours will do too. About the shuttlecocks, we heard, controversy is okay. We need a breath of fresh air. We need challenging. Might we hear the same about following a call to follow Jesus? Like, I don't know about you, but I need a breath of fresh air in the monotony of despair that encircles our tethered world right now. We are so tired of the way things are. We are so tired. We want a marvelous miracle from Jesus too, and we have zero desire to challenge the status quo one faithful act at a time. We are tired. But St. Paul's, with God's controversial help, things can be different. It doesn't have to look like stepping into COVID fights, but it can be the fight for hope. Hope is against the status quo right now, and it might be rejected, but we can believe that there is a disposition of life that does not have to throw our hands up in resignation, but rather throw our hands into the work of hope. You know what challenges the status quo right now? Not only giving grace, but receiving it. We are flexing and pivoting and enduring and asked to be resilient, and so many of us are giving grace to everybody around us. We know it's a hard time. We know. And the major and the controversial thing is that you can also give grace to yourself. It is okay if productivity isn't what it was when you weren't going through the trauma of a pandemic for 2 years. It's okay that you get scared sometimes. It is okay that there is an anger that you do not know what to do with or how to get rid of when the world is on fire like this. There is some sort of, you know, code of niceness that I think we find ourselves in as Christians doing all this nice. But there is a huge, big, gigantic chunk of following Jesus that means we allow ourselves to be nice to ourselves too, to offer the gift of receiving grace, knowing that we are forgiven, that we have never been asked to take on the burden of perfection. Risking rejection might look like our unwillingness to become numb to suffering, even when we find ourselves too exhausted to care like we hope. We never forget that God does. And there are real people on the other side of the pain. There is a risk in not becoming numb to the suffering. Risking rejection, it might look like setting boundaries with the relationships that are bringing you down. It doesn't mean you have to tell people where to go. It means recognizing that even Jesus did not have his full power for good around some of the people he thought he would. And he decided to tag his disciples and say, "You're it. Go out two by two. Do this." Risking rejection means trusting God's church to be in it together, so we never have to be in it alone. Risking rejection means standing up for policies that center those who have been rejected and believing those policies have a chance at giving us a glimpse of God's kingdom, whether it is, you know, around ability or race or gender or sexuality or age or family configuration or citizenship status or whatever. There is motivation for the rejection that might come by drawing the circle a little wider. Risking rejection means a relationship with money that sets aside wealth accumulation as the ultimate prize and instead prioritizes generosity and the health of a whole community. Risking rejection means finding God in the right now, the wrinkled hands that heal, or the walk around the block that chooses beauty over all the things that are missing. Or the conversation you had with your kid that takes time to genuinely listen to the answer. Or the time spent in class that welcomes the grace of God when all other voices say it is such a mess right now. When the shuttlecocks went up, there was controversy. And that rejection has transformed into a smile on the face of the city. Owning the ordinary, the vision of the regular everyday life. When Jesus went to his hometown, there was controversy, and that rejection transformed into a church that still lives on today, welcoming the controversy that builds God's kingdom. So the good news today is that the controversy is worth engaging in, even in a time like this. The rejection we face for hoping or practicing kindness or doing the right thing for far longer than we'd wanted to, that rejection is worth it too, because it is worth being on the side of Jesus, the one who changed the status quo with healing and justice. It's worth being on the side of the rejected Savior because we are gifted unconditional love. So may we have the holy boldness to stand transformed where the status quo had moved on repeat for so long, and see God's kingdom being built all around us. It might raise a fuss in the moment, but the future promise of a world littered with love is not a waste. So may we be faithful enough to be rejected. May we be faithful enough to be rejected, and may we lean on God's grace until we get to the other side of the controversy, until there are only smiles and a shared message of love in our future. May it be so. In the name of the Creator and the Redeemer and the Sustainer of us all. Amen. So we will have a chance to light candles. There's candles in the back and in the front of the room. If you're at home, we encourage you to light candles as well. It's also a time that we give, and you can see on the screen ways to give that will be on screen throughout this time as well. I encourage you to pray for those who are hurting right now. We know there are so many reasons to hurt, and it is really hard for everybody, but our prayer matters, and our prayer matters to God, and those people who are on our hearts matter to God, and so it's worth the rejection, you know. Oh, is prayer a waste, or is it a waste of time, or does it do anything? It's worth it. It's worth it. And so let us come to God in prayer, and let us go to God in generosity as we give.
Spirit of the living God, oh,
Spirit of the living God, fall fresh on me. Love me, hold me, fill me, use me. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. Spirit of the living God, fall fresh on me. Melt me, hold me, fill me. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me.
Let's pray together. Gracious God, loving God, God of our controversy and rejection, God of whimsy and God of tradition, we call out to you today because we turn to you as our refuge and our strength. When we are in the midst of a storm, whether one that brings us snow and ice and difficult traveling conditions, or those inner kinds of storms, the kind that comes from pandemic pain or from family heartache or loss. Strengthen us, God, and help us to withstand the worry that seems to consume us sometimes. And help us to withstand that exhausting work that we have in front of us, the work that wears us out but is so necessary to do. And help us to withstand that temptation to just give up in the midst of it all and to look for something that will comfort us, even if it's only for a moment, but not the kind of comfort that you offer to us, the everlasting strength and guidance that you give to us, but those kinds of comforts that are fleeting and momentary and in the end bring to us more pain than we had before. We pray, God, today to feel that steady presence of yours, to bring us your peace. Because God, we know that you are in the midst of our city, You are in the midst of all that we do. You are here when we are less than happy with what's going on in our neighborhoods. You are here in our hearts. You are here in our lives when we try to make sense of all that's going on around us. So comfort us today, God, with that strength, that guidance that only you can provide to us. For we feel like our world sometimes is in a lot of upheaval and a lot of pain. We pray today especially for the leaders of our world, we leaders of our nation, the leaders of our city, the leaders of our communities, that they will walk humbly with you and practice faithful discernment. Surround them, God, with honest truth tellers who will hold them to your ethic of love and justice. So even as we view the public art in our city, let us view your works of justice so that we can resonate with that and know that you are our God. Help us be still in the midst of all that threatens to disquiet us. Help us forget about the work that's still left undone, the chores that are piling up, the deadlines that are approaching. Help us for this moment to rest here in your presence, and help us to gaze upon you and know the truth that we belong to you and that we can't continue without the rest that you provide. And here in the stillness of this moment, let us embrace it as a great gift. Let us recognize it as a great truth. We are united together as the body of Christ. So as that body, hear us as we pray the prayer Christ taught us by saying together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
One of the ways that we, I believe, as the king, as God's people in the body of Christ, usher in the kingdom of God is by singing. Scripture says that God inhabits the praises of his people. Amen. So I'm going to invite you all to stand. We're going to sing an oldie that might be new, but we're going to sing Did You Feel the Mountains Tremble? Because we believe that in the simple, ordinary acts of singing, of coming together, of listening, that God moves the mountains. All right, let's sing the chorus. Open.
Open up the doors and let the music play. Let the streets resound with singing. Songs that bring your hope and songs that bring your joy. Dancers who dance upon injustice.
Did you feel?
Did you feel the mountains tremble? Did you hear the oceans roar? When the people rose to sing Jesus Christ, the risen one. Did you feel the people tremble? Did you hear the singers roar? When the lost began to sing out, Jesus Christ, the saving one. And we can see that God you're moving, mighty river. sweet, sweet sound we sing. Songs that bring your hope and songs that bring your joy. Dancers who dance upon justice. Do you feel the darkness tremble? All the saints join in one song, and all the streams flow as one river to wash away our woe.
Let's sing that again. Do you feel the darkness?
Do you feel the darkness tremble when all the saints join in one song, and all the streams flow as one river to wash away our brokenness?
We see,
and we can see that God you're moving. Time of jubilee is coming, but now we won't return to Jesus. Then why do heavenly gates prepare the way of the
that we're going to see the prison doors open, God. We believe we're going to see the mountains move, Lord. We know and claim that you're going to just do marvelous, amazing things. We feel it, Lord, in the everyday actions, Lord. We press into the everyday things that usher in the kingdom of God. And we go out feeling your power, Lord, that those everyday acts, even when we face rejection, will usher in the kingdom of God. Amen. You may be seated. You can stay standing. Please stay standing.
As we go from this place, may the love of God, the grace of Jesus Christ, and the power of the Holy Spirit go with you now and always, that we might not be afraid of rejection, but we might embrace it. Controversy can be good when it builds God's kingdom. Mm-hmm. Go in peace and go in controversy and serve the Lord. Mm-hmm. Amen.
Amen.